keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and low?
Lord, amen. We're glad to be in the house of God today, amen. We prayed this last week, just going to go ahead and let everyone else know that Sister Vardaman's granddaughter had passed away this last week. Her funeral services, private services, was this last Friday. Miss Bailey Smith, some of you guys knew who she was, and so we want to continue to be praying for the Vardaman family. In lieu of flowers, we did not send any flowers, anything from the church. In lieu of flowers, you can honor Bailey's memory by making a memorial donation to the Friends of the Smokies. I've had a couple that's wanted to make a donation towards for that in Bailey's honor. If you do want to do that, that'll be fine. Mark it on a tithe envelope and mark the name Bailey, B-A-I-L-E-Y, and the church will make a donation on Miss Sister Vardaman's behalf in the honor of Bailey to the Friends of the Smokies. So just remember that. If you're wanting to do that, may God bless you. We'll do that in the next couple of weeks. There's a couple of things coming up I want to remind you of. First of all, it's October the 15th. There we go. Okay. October the 15th at 4 o'clock, join us for a baby shower. Mom-to-be Aunt Miss Emma Busby, and baby's name is Everly Faith. Everly Faith. She is registered at Amazon and Walmart. If you're wanting to see the links of those, get with Sister Carrie, Sister Stephanie. They've got those links, and they can get that to you, and you can help out there. Also, next Sunday, that is two Sundays from now, but next Sunday, Dr. Walt Malden and Sister Tammy Malden will be here. They are the executive directors of Smoky Mountain Home for Children in Sevierville, Tennessee. I'm so looking forward to them being here with us. They're going to be presenting to us the things about the Home for Children, things that happens there in Sevierville, also with the ministries that they have there. And I'm looking forward to them being able to be back with us. We had scheduled them here a while back, and then COVID happened, and we've just now been able to get them back on the schedule to come. So I'm looking forward to them being here with us. So make sure that you are here for that event. That's going to be a great time to learn about the things that's going on at the Smoky Mountain Children's Home. Amen. I'm here today to worship a risen Amen. Savior. How about you? Amen. Hallelujah. Let's all stand and go to the Lord in prayer. I know that we've got several prayer requests. We've got needs. If you've got a prayer request and you're in-house, let it be known by the lifting of your hand. God knows every need. If you've joined us on live feed, you can text the keyword prayer to 205-642-8744 because we want to partner together in prayer. Dear kind and gracious Heavenly Father, as we come to today, I want to thank you for the blessings that you've given us. Thank you for this opportunity that you've allowed us to come to worship and praise you. Father, today I pray that you'll move and minister in a mighty way in our services. Father, you've seen the uplifting of the hands. You've seen all the prayer requests. You've seen the needs. And God, I pray right now that you'll move and minister in a mighty way. Open the windows of heaven upon this service today. Touch the praise team. Touch every person here, those that are on live feed. Father, I pray that you'd move and minister to the hearts and lives. We forever give you the praise, the honor, and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Let's give God a hand clap of praise. And let's worship this morning. Amen.
Amen. Yes, let's worship him in song. Let's sing of the mercies of the Lord.
My mouth
will I make known.
Jesus.
Spirit, flood my soul.
God, thank you, Jesus. Give God a hand clap of praise if you'll never be the same. Amen. Glory be to God. Amen. Awesome, awesome presence of God. You may be seated this morning. God is good. Amen. Amen. Again, we appreciate you being here with us today in the house of the Lord. Amen. Glory be to God. Amen. We've been talking over the last couple of months. I know, you're going to get tired of hearing these four words. Living what we believe. Living what we believe. This Sunday, there are some that are not able to be here due to this is race weekend. Some would say, well, why has that got to do with anything? It's always been an issue getting around and getting going any places, sometimes even on the interstate, sometimes with those different things like that. And so they've learned to live because they know those things happen. We've got to trust in God this morning. Amen? We've got to live what we believe. Amen? Amen. This morning, Sister Deborah is going and taking ages 4 through 12. I might I might get that before it's over with. Those that's been going with Sister Deborah learning these songs and getting things ready for the kids to be singing, they're going with her. I'm looking forward to hearing when they come in and they sing some of these songs that they've been learning. Amen. I'm really looking forward to it. I've heard that some of the kids have got different ones, have got solos, and they're going to be there. I'm looking forward to them coming in and leading us in worship. Amen. Amen. But we need to live what we believe. Amen. We need to understand that there's things that's going on in our lives, things that's happening, and you've learned to live with those things. Some of you've got, I just mentioned that about the racetrack, how that it's hard to maneuver certain areas because it's race weekend. Do I want to stay home just because it's race weekend? No. But I've learned, but some have learned, not us, some have learned you can't go certain places when it's race weekend. How many wants to go to Walmart or even go to Walmart on race weekend? You don't. Sister Carrie said, I got to go to Walmart. And then we realized I'm not going to Walmart. It's busy. It's chaotic. Why? Because we've learned those things. Other places that we've lived, didn't matter if it was race weekend, didn't matter what weekend it was. It was okay to go to some stores. But there's times that you can't. Why? We've learned to live with those things. Some of you have got vehicles. I've gotten into some of your vehicles and try to get out of the vehicle. You say you got to elbow it right there to get out. That's a certain place you got to elbow it. I've gotten in vehicles before to crank the vehicle and to move it, and they'll say, okay, nope, you got to turn the steering wheel just a certain way to make sure that you've learned those things over time. Why? Because it's your vehicle, it's your truck, it's your car. You've learned to live those things out. Why? Because that's something that you've become accustomed to. You've learned those things. Amen? It's the same thing it is with the Word of God. But unfortunately, there's times that we get ourselves into the place where we're just like, we're going through the motions. It's just a haphazard thing. We just go through the motions and we're just, well, we go to church on Sunday mornings. That's just what we do. Well, we just do these things just because that's what we do. Well, then we miss that first Sunday morning, and it's not as big of a deal, and then we realize that we've missed 14, and then we're like, how do I get back into being in the house of God? That happened back when COVID hit, and I've had a couple of you come to me and tell me it was hard getting back into the habit of doing. This is just the way things are. I mean, amen. This is the things that's happened in our lives, but we've had to get ourselves back into the habit of doing things for God. And as far as living what we believe, there's things that we just know that it's existence, but we don't really know why. We believe that the Word of God is the truth of God's Word. We just don't know why we believe certain aspects of the Scripture, but we think that this other really doesn't apply to us. We don't know why. We just think those things. Why? Because it's been passed down from generation to generation, from one Sunday school class to another, and that's just what we was told, and we just go back and forth, and we just say, well, that must be the truth, because we was told that. Well, how many knows that we need to hear it from the Word of God in order to know what God says about the matter? Amen? It's not about what I think, but it's about what God thinks. Last couple of Sundays, we've talked about the word holiness, and that's where we're at. We've talked about the word holiness, and look, I'm going to just tell you, at a time growing up, when I was a kid, that's some of the things that I was told is that this is what holiness is. It fits in this little box over here, and that's what holiness is all about. But nobody told me what the Scripture was that said that that's what holiness was about. And then I've had some to tell me according to the Bible, we've got to do, these are some of the things that we've got to do. These are some of the requirements we have to have in order to be saved. These are some of the steps we've got to take in life. And I stepped back and I thought, that doesn't sound really right. So I just sort of was just listening to what was said. And this was being said in churches. And I said, can you show me the scripture that applies to that? And Brother Kevin, you know what I was told? You're closed-minded. You're closed-minded and you'll never understand what we're trying to tell you. No, I'm as open-minded as you can get about this. I want you to give me the scriptures till I know what it is. They never could do it. And you know why they couldn't do it? Because it wasn't the scripture. That's exactly right. It wasn't the scripture. She knew. Natalie knew what was going on. It ain't scripture. And that's what we've got to realize is if it's not backed up by the Word of God, then it's not something we need to apply to our belief system and in our lives. And I'm going to tell you something else. We can, and it happens so many times with people. You can get yourself to a point where you can pull a verse of Scripture out of the Bible and you can make it say what you want it to believe, and it's not what God was wanting it to say. Why? Because you took it out of context. People take things out of context. What we've got to understand is we've got to take the whole Word of God. We've got to take the entirety of the Scripture to understand what God's Word says. And we know that the Word of God says that in Matthew 28, verse 18, that all authority has been given unto Jesus Christ, the Son of God, by God Himself. And so with that being the case, and that being what we base our foundation of the Word of God on, the Word of God being the authority of God, we base all of that on that, then we need to know what the Word of God tells us. Last Sunday we talked about the fact that as children of God, as a believer, we're to follow and to strive after holiness. We've come to the realization and understanding that we know that the word holiness means sanctification, consecration, separation. We know that God's Word wants us to be different, to be peculiar. My daughter has said, I live up to that peculiar word. I really don't know if she was meaning that good or bad, but I'll take it. Everywhere I go, you're going to hear something about church. Everywhere I go, you're going to hear something about God. We were somewhere yesterday, and it was not a church event. I really don't know what anybody in that place thought about a church. I don't know if anybody went to church, but everybody there knew that I was the pastor of Coosa Valley Church of God, and I believe that God is reigning on high. Amen? Why? Because that's who I am. I'm peculiar. And I like it. I did hear from somebody later after we left, and they said, the person texted me after they got home, and they said, everybody liked you guys today. I was like, yay. I really wanted them to think that I was peculiar, but, you know, okay, I'll take it. What we've got to realize and understand is in order for us to be separated and to set apart is we need to set ourselves apart unto God and to Him alone. We need to separate ourselves from the world and the pleasures and the possession, the things of this world. Guess what? We've got things. There's nothing wrong with people having things in their life. But when we overdo it, we've put materials ahead of God. You know, there's things about that that people don't like to hear and don't like to talk about. There's nothing wrong with a believer buying possessions, but we're not to be a materialist. There's nothing wrong with us eating, but we're not to be a glutton. There's nothing wrong with us sleeping, but we're not to be slothful. There's nothing wrong with us working, but we don't need to be a workaholic. There's nothing wrong with playing, but we don't need to overemphasize recreation. We can have a house and a home, but we're not to hoard the riches of this world. There's nothing wrong with fellowship. How many knows I love fellowship? I love getting together with people and having a good old time together. I love those things. But there's something wrong about doing nothing but that and not getting along with God. We've got to be separated from the world. Last Sunday we ended on three verses. I read these three verses. And I'll read these again because this leads us right into where we're at today. One thing is very clear about the scriptures over the last several weeks. One thing is very clear. We need to be looking at a principle of sanctification, a principle of holiness in our lives, because that is the covenant in which God wants us to live in. So last Sunday I read these verses, these three verses. I read 2 Corinthians chapter 7 and verse 1. And it says this, since we have these promises, let us cleanse ourselves from every defilement of the body and the spirit, bringing holiness to completion in the fear of God. We also looked at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 15 and 16, and it says this, but as he who called you is holy. Guess what? God has called you. He set you apart. He wants you to be holy. Amen. He wants us set apart. So we need to be holy. Why? Because God is holy. You need to be holy in all of your conduct. Then it also goes in and says, since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. Then we also looked at 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 11. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be? In life, you need to be holy, have holiness and godliness. Those are the things we need to strive for. Those are what we need to pursue after. Those are the things we need to long after. We need to be holy. Why? Because God is holy. So we stop and we look at the Greek word. The Greek word that's translated as sanctified, or to sanctify, it means to make holy, to set apart, to dedicate, to purify. This word is then translated as sanctification, and that means holiness, separated from profane things. We've not just been justified just to have something to do, but we've been justified or saved so that we can strive towards that sanctification with God. We're not just, look, there's so many times people are saved and they think, whoop, I've gotten saved. Woo, hallelujah. Let me shake my leg. And now I'm saved, and that's all there is to it. There's more to life than just that. God is calling us for greater things than just the beginning. Think about somebody who got a job. Think about somebody who got a job in the mailroom. There's nothing wrong with being in the mailroom of a industry or a place of employment. There's nothing wrong with starting off in that slot. But think of somebody that's gotten a job in the mailroom and they never had the thought process, the willpower, or the drive or the pursuit to do anything other than work in the mailroom. They started in the mailroom when they're 17 years old and that's all they ever wanted to do. They retired in the mailroom and they're 67 years of age. They've done the same thing their entire life, and that's all they've ever done is they worked in the mailroom. There's nothing wrong with working in a mailroom. There's nothing wrong with starting on the bottom floor. But I want you to know something. As far as our spiritual walk with God, I want to start on ground floor, that is being saved. And I don't want to stay there. I want to grow deeper in God. I want to grow higher in what God has for me. I don't want just the beginning. I want all of what God has in store. We start off at the mailroom and we start in the beginning. That's being saved. I want more of God. Well, I got sanctified. And I realized that God still got more for me. God still has more. God's got more in our life. God's got the greater things in our life. God wants us to dig deeper. God wants us to wade out a little further. God don't want us to stay in mediocre. God wants us to go greater. Every one of us, everybody, when you've gotten a job, you just come out of high school, you get a job, and you don't want to just do the same thing for the rest of your life. You want to do more. You want to dig deeper. You want to do greater things. You want to pursue. You want to keep moving forward. You want to keep. That's the same thing it is with us and God. Back a little over 100 years ago, there was some church folks that got together. And they went into the little mountaintops. They went into the hillside. They went into a little cabin. They started talking amongst themselves. There's about 20, 25 of them in that little bitty room. And they said, you know what? We know that there's more of God. There's more to God. There's more to this relationship that we have with our Heavenly Father. There's more about what God has for us than what we've been taught. There's got to be more. And you know what they did? You know what this handful of people did? They started praying. They started seeking God. They started reading their Bible. And you know what happened? There was a Holy Ghost revival that fell in that little cabin. And you know what happened? There was born the denomination Church of God. A Pentecostal movement that has spread. Why? Because people realize there's more to God than what we've been taught. In church, there's more to God. God's just wanting to know, are you wanting more of Him? That's all God's wanting to know. The process that begins with a movement of us getting saved, it continues throughout our life as long as we're digging deeper in the Word of God. Well, you know what, Brother Andy? I've got all I want. I've got all of God that I want. I've got all of God I need. Things are good. I'm going to make it to heaven. Glory to God. And you know what? This is all I need. Because if I got more, then I would be a peculiar person like you. There ain't nothing wrong being peculiar. Why? Because people know I'm different. Do you know what? I'm glad people know I'm different than what's going on in the society and the world we're living in. I'm glad people know that I am different. I have been set apart. There's something different about me. And you know what? It ain't got nothing to do with the way I part my hair. It ain't got nothing to do with how I dress. I wasn't in a suit and tie yesterday. I've gone into Home Depot before and seen people that I didn't know who they was. Miss Katie will tell you, we walked in there one time. I said, look, we got 5 minutes. We got to get in there, get what we need, and we got to get out of there. So she said, well, I'm staying in the truck. I said, no, you got to come with me to make sure that I stay on my time schedule. This is where we got to go. Don't let me stop. She fails at her job, by the way. She said, because I don't listen. You know what? It's okay. Why? Because I need to tell somebody about who Jesus is. I'm not ashamed. Brother Andy, don't you realize that people are going to look at you weird? I was at Six Flags one. Brother Andy, you went to Six Flags? I sure did. I went to Six Flags one time. I was at Six Flags one time, and y'all, look, most of the folks that was in my group, and me and Sister Carrie was dating at this time. I think she even did it too. Most of the people in my group, they'd walk away from me when I'd start this. People would start looking at you because you're different. People started looking at, and I'd look right back at them. I got mustard on my face. They'd start looking at me, and I'd start trying to fix myself. Is everything? What's wrong? It's okay that people look at you weird. You know what? In 1,000 years, really, is it going to matter that somebody looked at you weird because you're a Christian? What's going to matter is how many people did you witness to about Jesus? How many people did you tell about the Son of God? That's what's going to matter in 1,000 years. In 1,000 years, it's not going to matter about calculus. Although there are those that's in school, they need to know calculus. My teachers told me that my geometry, my trigonometry, my calculus, and all those algebra things, I'd use them for the rest of my life. I really didn't think I'd ever used any. I don't think I've ever used any of them since I left high school, or excuse me, since I left college. But I've used them more than I realized, but not like they taught me. These big old numbers all over this page and all this stuff. Brother Emory's fixing to pick up a book and throw it at me because he's a retired math teacher. Did you teach calculus? You didn't teach Common Core neither, did you? You believe 2 + 2 = 4, right? Okay. You'll always use that. But in 1,000 years, Brother Emory, retired math, how many years did you teach math? In 1,000 years, is it going to really matter how many A's you gave out, how many B's you gave out? Is it going to matter that, or is it going to matter how many people we witness to about God? Do you see what I'm saying? Yes, our kids need to know math. Yes, they need to know English. But I'm going to tell you something. They need to know who Jesus is, greater than everything else. We've got to know who Jesus is. We've got to put the emphasis on those things. We need to realize, wait, y'all got to get this one. Hang on, y'all ready? You need to realize that the gospel message is not about sin management, but it is about transformation into Christ's likeness in this life. Did you know the gospel is not about sin management, but it is about transforming who we are to be like Christ? Christ is one that had no sin. He was perfected. He was perfect. He who had no sin yet went to the cross for our sins. So the gospel message is not about managing our sin, but it is about transforming our life to a life like Christ. We need to be like Jesus. We need to be more like Him. We can think about salvation in a threefold way. Justification. We've been saved from the penalty of sin. Now, I'm going to pause right there. Sin has consequences. I got two people that agree with me. Sin has consequences. Amen? Now, listen. If you've got sin in your life, You can ask God to forgive you. And the penalty of that sin, Jesus has already paid on the cross of Calvary. But you need to understand the consequences of that sin. That's not the same thing as the penalty of that sin. Does that make sense? If I slap somebody and I ask them, forgive me, they may forgive me, but they're not going to get close enough for me to slap them again. Right? It's always going to be a consequence because I hit them. They ain't getting close enough for me to hit them again. Why? Because they got common sense. Hello? Somebody was talking about the other day about forgiving and forgetting. God forgives of our sins. God will forget those sins existed in our life. Why? Because they're under the blood of Calvary. The devil is the one that brings that sin back up and reminds us and God about that sin. Hello? What we've got to understand is that when God has removed that sin and the devil tries to bring it back, tell him, you're under my foot. You're under my foot. You're under my foot. You walking around Walmart and the devil's trying to bring up your sin. You don't just walk around there, Sister Bonnie, and just say, devil, you're under my foot. You're walking in Walmart. Tell him, devil, you're under my foot. Brother Andy, somebody look at me like I'm crazy. So what? They'll put you in the category, you're peculiar. And that's biblical. It's time we've got some Christians that started being peculiar. I got to get this thing rolling. Come on now. We're under a new covenant of holiness. Now, y'all, look, I know what the clock says. I got 16 minutes till noon. This is race weekend. All the restaurants in town's going to be busy. So it'll be all right. So let's just hold on and let's move, okay? I need y'all to hear this, okay? We're under a new covenant of holiness. Okay? There's the old covenant under the messianic law, under the laws of Moses. Those covenants that's there, we're not under that anymore. We're under a covenant of holiness and grace. Everybody with me? Hey, babies don't disturb me. Watch right here. Okay? We can keep rolling. Sometimes I want to cry like that too. In church. All right, watch this. We're under a new covenant. Do you know why I like babies crying in church? Because that means we got growth. Hello? I've had mamas and daddies tell me, Brother Andy, I can't come to church because my baby will cry during church. I don't care. Bring them. I want babies crying. You know why? Growth is happening. But Brother Andy, that interferes with me. Look, listening to the Word of God. Look, it don't interfere you when you're in a restaurant eating food. It don't interfere with you sleeping because some of your daddies slept through the... Never mind, I did. All right, let's go. Come on. Some reason it only affects people in church. I don't know. Come on, watch this. We're under a new covenant of holiness. Watch Jeremiah 31. Look, I got three verses I'm going to throw to you quickly. Watch this, because y'all need to get this. This new covenant of holiness. Come on. Jeremiah 31. 31 through 33. Look. Behold. That's God saying, wake up. Listen, behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make, y'all, this is Old Testament, right? Am I reading Old Testament? This is a prophetic word about what is coming
in the days ahead. This is talking about basically what you and I are living in. Behold, the days are coming when I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judea, not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of Egypt. My covenant that they broke. Y'all hear that? Look at this. Fourth line down. Look at what it says. My covenant that they broke. I don't want to break the covenant between me and God. I don't want to break that covenant between me and God. Why? Because I have been bought and been paid for by the blood of the Lamb on the cross of Calvary. Amen. Though I was their husband, declares the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Guess what? If you will declare that God is your God, then guess what? You will be His people. I don't know about you, but I'm glad to know that I'm a child of God. What is your identity? What do you identify? This is what's been going around. I got an email the other day. And I was reading the email, and I looked all the way down, and the person had their name there, and they wrote their pronouns out beside it. I was thinking, y'all, I really want to put what my identification is out beside my name on my email. I'm going to start doing this. This is going to be my signature on my thing. It's going to say Pastor Andy Lambert. Under it's going to be in parentheses. It says identification, child of God. Reckon how many's going to get ugly at me about that? Quite frankly, I don't care. Why? Because I'm a child of God. We need to start showing our identification with God. Amen? Come on. I'm not ashamed. Let's go on. I don't know about y'all, but listen. The loudest person in here that is supporting me is Natalie. Come on now. She's 6 months old. 7 months old, 8 months old. I got an 8 month old giving me more. Come on now. All she's doing is saying amen. Y'all got to help her. I love it. Let's go on. Look. Luke chapter 22, verse 20. Likewise, the cup after they had eaten, saying, this cup is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. 2 Corinthians 3:3-6. And you show that you are a letter from Christ delivered by us, written not with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God. Guess what, church? God is not dead. I got three of you that supports that. I'm going to this side now. God's not dead. There's so many that they worship a dead God and their God can't do doodle them squat. But I'm so glad to know that my God's alive. He's alive and well. Come on. But written with the Spirit of the living God, not on the tablets of stone. Why? Because stone can be broken. But on the tablets of the human heart. Such is the confidence that we have through Christ toward God. Not that we are sufficient in ourselves to claim anything as coming from us, but our sufficiency is from God, who has made us sufficient to be ministers of a new covenant. Not of the letter, not of the law, but of the Spirit. All she's doing is talking to me. Y'all need to talk to me too. Say amen, hallelujah, do something. For the letter kills, the law kills, but the Spirit gives us life. Now, why is it good that we're under the new covenant? The old covenant, when Israel failed to keep, was forced to leave the promised land that God had promised to them. Forced to give away the blessings that God had promised them. Forced to give away what God had given to them. I'm going to tell you something, church. The devil ain't taking what God's given to me. The song is this. I don't think we've ever... Have we sung that song here? Went to the enemy's camp. I don't think we've sung it much. But I'm going to tell you something, church. You know, the song, went to the enemy's camp, took back what he stole from me. He can't steal what you give unless you give it to him. You ain't going to steal my shoes unless you take them from me. Y'all hear me? You ain't going to take my shoes unless you take them, but you got to whoop me really bad to get them. Or I have got to give them to you. If Marty wants my shoes, he's going to have to either whoop me or I got to give them to him. Well, there's too many people that has allowed the devil to whoop them when greater is he that's in me than he that is in the world. There's too many that's given to the devil what the devil wants out of their lives and they should hang on to it. The devil wants your family. You need to hang on to it. The devil wants your blessings. You need to hang on to them. The devil wants your finances. You better hang on to it. The devil wants your health. You better hang on to it. Don't give the devil control over what he wants in your life. You need to keep a hold of what God has given to you. Come on now. Let's go on. Our external behavior needs to be transformed. What does that mean? Well, under the old covenant, we were trying to conform ourselves to an outward set of rules. Y'all think about that. Have you ever stopped and really tried to focus on the 360 plus rules of the Mosaic Law? Have you ever stopped and really thought about it? Think about what is said. You can't harvest corn on the Sabbath. That's external, right? That's external, right? It talks about purification things. All external. It talks about if you're sick, you got leprosy. This is what you got to do. You got to go outside the city. You got to stay there for 7 days for purification. External. Are y'all hearing that? You go back through and you watch that. All of those things are external. But the new covenant, God's wanting to transform and to change our hearts and our lives from the inside out. Because God knows that once the heart changes, everything else is going to change. Remember, we've talked about this. You ain't going to change, and you ain't going to change nobody unless they want to change. There ain't nobody going to change me unless I want to make a change. Because she wants to change. If her mom and daddy wanted her to change and she didn't want to, guess what? She ain't going to because she don't want to. Right? But when she wants to change her shoes, she'll put them on the wrong feet, but she's going to change. We've got to want to. Aren't y'all glad we got babies in church? They make things lively. Come on. You've got to want to make a change in your life. You can't change. You can't change because just because somebody wants you to. You've got to make a change because you want to make that change. Amen? That's the difference in our lives. That's what's taking place in our lives. We've got to want to. Guess what? God wants to make a change in our lives. But we've got to change it. I've told y'all that about me and Sister Carrie getting married. First argument. Wasn't an argument. I just say it was. I don't want anybody to think I had an argument and lost, or that she had an argument and I lost anyway. I want you to understand the first argument was how to fold towels. Guess what I figured out very quickly, Brother Art? She was right and I was wrong. Why? I was not changing, but it wasn't a change that I said. I said I wanted to make that change. Why? Because she wanted that change to make. I could have stood my ground, dug my heels in, but guess what? That's what a lot of church folks have done. God wants to make a change in their lives. They've dug their... Y'all hear this. Y'all want y'all to listen to this. This is closing. Y'all need to hear this. Y'all really need to hear this. Church folks, God has wanted to make a change in our lives, and there are church folks that have dug... I said, God wanted to make a change in our lives, and church folks has dug their heels in and said, if God wants to change me, he'll come and change me himself. God wants to make a change in our lives, but too many times church folks will say, that ain't God. God wants to change us. We've got to let him. When God does an internal change, the external is going to follow. External behaviors in holiness, external behaviors must be transformed as well. God wants to transform all of us into the creature he wanted us to be. Our hearts and our desires are constantly pushing us towards what holiness is all about. God wants to change our lives. Will you let him? Would you stand? I had somebody actually tell me this, Brother Kevin. They come to me and they said, if God wants me to do that, then he'll come down and he'll move me to do that. And I look back over their life with them, and I seen all the times that God had the writing on the wall, so to speak, for them to make a change. But you need to hear this, because they did not want to change. Because that's not the way we've always done it. Because they did not want to change. Because that's not what grandmama and grandpapa said. Because they did not want to change. Because that'll make me do something different. Guess what? God moved on and used somebody else and gave somebody else the blessing that was meant for their life. There's times God wants to change us. And God wants to bless us, but we've got to be willing to accept the change. Amen? If you need anything from God, we're fixing to go to God in prayer. Whatever the needs are, my God is able. I'm going to ask you something. And everybody in here fall into one of these categories, I'm sure. First, is there anybody that need? I'm not asking you to raise your hands. I'm not asking anybody to point you out. This is the questions I'm asking. Is there somebody here that's not saved? If you was to die, you know you would go to hell. Or, I really don't know where I would go. I'm going to tell you something. The altar's the place you need to be. Brother Andy, there's something going on in my physical. I need a healing touch physically in my life. Guess what? I know the great physician. Brother Andy, there's something financial going on in my life. I need God to do something financially in my life. You know what? I know the God that owns the cattle of 1,000 hills. And there's nothing too big for my God. Whatever your need is, I know that God is able. Why? Because I know a prayer-answering God. The question is, do you have faith to trust in Him or under your own understandings? Will you trust in God this morning? Whatever it is, man says it can't happen. My God says it's able. With man, things are impossible, but with God, all things are possible. Whatever the need may be, God's able to move. Would you bow your heads and let's pray this morning? Dear Heavenly Father, as we're bowing our heads and we're praying, you need something from God. Would you just come on to this altar? Whatever the needs are, God is able to move. God's able to minister. God's able to touch. And I promise you, somebody's going to meet you in this altar. Look, I need some prayer warriors to come. Come on. Come on. I need some ladies on my left-hand side. Come on. Right-hand side of the altar. I need some folks to come. Come on. Come on. Church, I know that my God is able. But you've got to take a step of faith and allow God to work. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you today, God, I know you're able to move. I know you're able to minister. Whatever the needs are in this house, those that are in-house and those that are on live feed alike, God, I know you're able to move and I know you're able to minister. But God, I'm praying right now that your Holy Spirit anointing will touch one more time. Whatever the need may be, whatever the situation, God, I know you're able to move. I know you're able to minister. God, we're just trusting. We're depending on you today. Father, I thank you for what you're going to do in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Live feed, thank you so much for joining with us. Join us back Wednesday at 6:30. May God bless you. Amen and amen.